On Monday, SpaceX was spotted loading some of the first Starlink V2 satellite prototypes into a custom mechanism designed to refill Starship's magazine-like payload bay. While it's not the first time SpaceX has used the dispenser, the photos captured by photographer Kevin Randolph are the first to clearly show real prototypes of the next generation of Starlink satellites. Join us as we bring you, Elon Musk is not wait to try Starlink V2 satellite in Starship first test flight. According to CEO Elon Musk, those Starlink Gen2 or V2 satellites will be at least 5 times better, an order of magnitude more capable, and about 4 times heavier than current Starlink satellites. The potential of the new satellite bus design paired with Starship's massive fairing and lift capacity could dramatically improve the viability and cost-effectiveness of SpaceX's Starlink constellation. First, though, the company needs to launch and qualify prototypes of the new satellite design, and verify that all associated ground support equipment works as expected. Due to the designs SpaceX has settled on for both Starlink V2 satellites, and the Starship hardware that will deploy them in orbit. That ground support equipment and the general path each satellite will take from its arrival at the launch facilities to lift off on a Starship are wildly different than anything done before. July 18th, TIS photos and screenshots from a recent factory tour confirm that the next-gen satellites are basically enlarged versions of their smaller predecessors, which are also narrow rectangles. The new spacecraft have a very similar aspect ratio, but are around 7 meters long and 3 meters wide. They also appear to be about twice as thick, and reportedly weigh approximately 1,250 kilograms. As a result, the V2 bus will have about 7 to 10 times more usable volume than version 1 and V1.5. It should be no surprise, then, that each next-gen satellite could offer almost magnitude more usable bandwidth. Assuming that Starship launch costs are roughly the same as Falcon 9, and that Starship can only launch a similar 50 to 60 satellites at once. An almost 10x performance improvement from a satellite that only weighs 5 times as much relative to V1.5, would make Starlink V2.0 constellation deployment at least twice as cost-efficient to deploy. Even if Starship could only launch the same mass, approximately 16 tons, as Falcon 9. In fact, a recent SpaceX render suggests that Starship will be able to carry 54 Starlink V2.0 satellites initially. As a result, even if Starship costs 5 times more to launch than Falcon 9, $75M, it will still be cheaper per unit of bandwidth launched. If Starship eventually reaches marginal launch costs, as low as Falcon 9, $15M, the cost of Starlink launches not including satellite cost, could plummet from about $15,000 per gigabit per second, to around $1,500-2,500 per gigabit per second, depending on individual satellite bandwidth. The total cost of the network will be higher, of course, and dependent on more variables. But the combination of Starship and V2.0 satellites could eventually reduce the relative cost of Starlink launch operations by a factor of 5 to 10. If Starlink V2.0 satellites are actually cheaper to manufacture per unit of throughput than V1.5 satellites, which is not implausible once mass production begins, those savings will deepen. If Starship can quickly mature and becomes fully and efficiently reusable, the equation could become even more favorable. Still, loading Starship with satellites is going to be no minor feat, and will add a significant amount of complexity and risk relative to the methods SpaceX currently uses for Falcon 9 Starlink launches. SpaceX's initial Starship payload bay design is a roughly square enclosure that slots just above the ship's uppermost tank dome and below its inward curving nose cone. For a render of the mechanism released last month, it measures about 9 meters 30 feet tall, and 8 meters 26 feet wide, can store up to 54 Starlink V2.0 satellites, and dispenses pairs of satellites through a relatively tiny payload bay door, that's only wide enough for the task at hand. Starship's airframe is almost exclusively welded together. Once the nose cone and payload bay are installed on top of a ship, the only way to access the interior of the bay is through the dispenser door, or an even smaller human-sized access port. SpaceX's solution, build a mobile satellite storage box that will be lifted by crane or launch tower arms dozens to hundreds of feet off the ground, and use the payload bay's own dispenser mechanism in reverse to load satellites like bullets into a giant magazine. If that sounds simple, which it shouldn't, it's not. It's great, then, to see SpaceX apparently practicing that process with some of the first Starlink V2.0 prototypes. In photos captured on July 18, workers were spotted loading several satellites into the only existing loader, inside one of Starbase's three main factory tents. Each satellite was lifted using a load spreader device that was presumably required to prevent the extremely long and thin satellites from bending too much in the middle during the lift. It's unclear whether SpaceX is solely practicing the process, or if it's actually installing satellites well in advance for loading onto a Starship prototype. Back in August 2021, I surmised that just like it has with Falcon 9, SpaceX would again try to optimize its new Starlink V2.0 satellite design to take maximum advantage of Starship's launch performance. In an updated Starlink Gen 2 filing, the company conveniently revealed that a version of the constellation optimized for Starship would be structured such that the rocket could launch an entire orbital plane, one ring of satellites spaced evenly around the Earth in one go. In that constellation variant, all but approximately 500, 1.5% of almost 30,000 spacecraft, would be stationed in planes of 110 or 120 satellites. Meaning that it was safe to assume that SpaceX meant that every Starship would nominally carry 110 to 120 satellites. Using Musk's latest optimistic Starship performance estimate of 150 tons to low Earth orbit, that all but guaranteed that a Starship optimized Starlink V2.0. Starship S-24 is in the middle of pre-flight testing, and has already been greeted by the satellite loader once before. Possibly to load a prototype, or mock-up before ground testing began. Starship S-25 appears to be at least a month or two away from completion, though its nose and payload bay section are much closer. Even despite those massive advantages, SpaceX's Starlink Gen 2 ambitions still leave it no slack whatsoever. If the FCC approves its license request, SpaceX would need to launch half of the constellation within 6 years. Equivalent to around 130 Starship launches, or 22 Starship launches per year. In comparison, Falcon 9, a rocket that's 10 times smaller, less reusable, and has been flying since 2010, did not achieve 22 launches in 1 year until 2020. For Starship to have any hope of achieving the cadence Starlink Gen 2 requires, SpaceX would have to ramp up launches of the largest rocket ever built, at a truly miraculous pace, and suffer very few failures or setbacks along the way. Starlink will always be bottlenecked by the number of satellites that can be simultaneously available over any single point on Earth. So the constellation will never be able to match a ground network 1-1 with the same installed capacity, but it's safe to assume that Starlink Gen 2 could serve tens or even hundreds of millions of users, located anywhere on Earth, if SpaceX is able to build it. Thanks for watching this video, and it's a super interesting topic. If you like this, make sure to subscribe. If you have any crazy ideas about what we should cover in next video, please comment it below, and we'll see if we can get to it. So thanks again for watching and goodbye.